Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Widdershins Adventures by Ari Marmell, narrated by Nanette Savard, with performances by Alyssa Wilmoth, Eric Messner, Thomas Keegan, Yasmin Tuazon, Nick DePinto, Christopher Graybill, Bob Payne, Michael Glenn, Steve Wannall, Bradley Smith, Dawn Ursula, Christopher Walker, Danny Gavigan, Harlan Work, David Coyne, Scott McCormick, Colleen Delany, Stephen Carpenter, Matthew Bassett, Lily Beacon, Elizabeth Jernigan, Drew Kopas, Terence Aselford, Thomas Penny, Nathanial Perry, and Richard Rowan. Book 1, Thief's Covenant.
Two years ago, 15-year-old Adrienne Satie watched, helpless, as the world turned red beneath her. The girl clung, first to the walls above, where few could even have attempted to climb, and then to the rafters, terrified to move, to breathe, to think, lest she accidentally attract a murderous eye. No matter how Adrienne tried, no matter how hard she bit her own hand in a desperate attempt at silence, she couldn't entirely suppress her sobs. Her body shook with them. Her face glistened. But any sounds she made were lost in the carnage below. Any tears that fell vanished in the sheen of blood that covered the floor. Blood that, minutes before, had pumped from the hearts of men and women she knew. Men and women she loved. Long after the slaughter had ended, long after silence had fallen, Adrienne Satie could only clutch the rafters with both arms and legs, her eyes squeezed tight, and pray. Thin strands of mold clung to broken mortar along a wall of bricks. The watery tendrils of twisting underground estuaries and man-made sewers flowed beyond those walls, sweeping away the city's filth, twisting and wearing away at the brickwork, keeping it consistently damp.
One can as easily find a tax collector without scars as a cellar beneath the city of Davion without mold.
Yet it was neither mold nor condensation weighing down the chamber's stagnant air, obscuring the abstract designs on the burnished flagstones. Rather, it was blood. Almost inconceivable quantities of it, mixing with the mold into a foul sludge, seeping through cracks in the floor, seeking a return to the primal earth. Scattered across those ornate tiles lay an obscene carpet of limbs and other less recognizable bits that had so recently stood upright, talked and laughed, and borne names.
This is a mess.
Sergeant Christophe Chapelle of the Davion City Guard cautiously examined the floor to ensure he was not about to set foot on a corpse or part of one. A second glance followed to ensure that his gauntlet had not picked up any of the stray filth that caked the walls. Only then did Chapelle carefully smooth his salt and pepper mustache, poking in the process at the camphor extract that he and the others had applied to their nostrils.
Dima, save their souls.
We're gonna have to count heads.
Sir, I think...
Chapelle turned toward the young recruit, Julien Bunyar. Soft, unassuming features and slightly drooping eyelids belied both wit and reflexes at least as keen as the service rapier that hung loosely at his hip. Like the sergeant, he wore the black tabard of the guard, emblazoned with the silver fleur-de-lis, and a medallion of Dimas, patron deity of the guard, around his neck. A medallion he rubbed gingerly between thumb and finger, seeking comfort and strength. Only his ribbons of rank differentiated his uniform from that of his sergeant. Well, those and the abstract patterns of blood on his boots.
What is it, Constable Bunyar?
I've identified one of the dead, sir.
Not a good sign.
And who might that be?
Sir, I really think you'd better see this for yourself. If I'm wrong...
Understood, Constable. Show me.
They crossed the chamber, stopping beside one particularly hideous corpse. Chappelle crouched perfunctorily beside the body Julian indicated.
This isn't even a proper body.
Everything that gave life, everything that was supposed to be found within the body, was scattered around instead, ripped out through a gaping chasm in the abdomen. It was the work of no weapon with which the sergeant was familiar. A bear, maybe, or a panther, if such a beast had somehow developed a sadistic taste for suffering. Unable to put it off any longer, Chappelle turned his attention to the victim's face. A horrified expression was forever etched into the man's features. Clearly, the fellow saw exactly what was coming and couldn't do a damn thing about it.
Demas. It's Robert Verreau.
In shock himself, Chappelle lacked the wherewithal to reprimand his men for their murmurs.
I have another one, sir. I think it's Marie Richelieu.
Demas, death.
Chappelle mentally berated himself. He never cursed in front of the men. Sure enough, he recognized the pert features and ravishing blonde curls of Marie Richelieu, though a sizable portion of her left cheek was absent. The Lady Richelieu was the young matriarch of a household that was, if anything, wealthier even than House Verreau. The old guardsman, growing visibly older by the instant, could only shake his head.
The House Richelieu is accustomed to scandal and slander, Constable, but this is not the sort of public affair with which the House is equipped to deal.
And if there are two, sir, how many more?
Men, examine every face you can find.
With each positive identification, Chappelle's world tilted farther off its axis. Pierre Montrond, Josephine Poumet, Darien Lamarche, Gaston Carnot, the Marquis de Brielle. No, they couldn't put a name to every face, not even a face to every victim. But every last soul they could identify hailed from the ranks of Davion's rich and powerful. Each name they recorded was another house about to become the stuff of rumor, another god bereft of a most eminent follower.
Turn over every inch of this room. If there are clues to be found, they could be hidden beneath this carpet of blood. And they aren't about to leap out and reveal themselves.
Sir!
The guardsmen applied an extra dose of the disease-shielding camphor to their noses, swallowed their rising gorges, and began to sift. Above their heads, a pair of fearful eyes in an oceanic shade, hovering indecisively on the cusp between blue and green, blinked open to watch the guardsmen. The rafters atop which the blood-smeared Adrienne had scurried were thin, dusty, precarious. Yet she crouched among them carelessly, a human spider clinging to her perch, breathing through her mouth in a futile attempt to avoid the grisly fetor. Her whole body trembled as a thrill of panic danced spastically up her spine, sending a trickle of dust raining from the rafters. Her own fear momentarily overwhelmed by this external alien emotion, she twisted her head to glance over her shoulder, though she knew no one was present. Not physically, at least.
Stop that. This is hard enough without you distracting me.
Through the fear, Adrienne sensed a faint but unmistakable tingle of sheepishness. She glanced downward once more, fingers grasping reflexively at the wooden beam.
Right, then. I'm going down there.
A spike of terror, one that came from the other rather than from her own soul, rooted her in place.
Oh!
One of the guardsmen craned his neck upward, seeking uselessly to penetrate the shadows that clung to the ceiling in the lantern light. Pushing back the brim of his plumed hat, he shook his head irritably.
Now see what you almost did? When we get out of this, we're gonna have a serious talk as to who's in charge here.
Sergeant Chappelle!
Oh, they think this is horrible? Where were they while I was watching it happen?
A swell of sympathy and understanding washed over her from the unseen presence.
Oh, shut up!
What is it, Constable?
Sir, I found a loose stone in the wall here. There's a lever of some sort hidden behind it.
Oh, figs!
With an old, practiced eye, Chappelle studied the large brick. The brick lifted easily, despite its apparent mass, from its housing. A lever, perhaps a foot long, was concealed behind it. Chappelle took a single, all-encompassing glance around the room, trying to discern what the mechanism might do.
Well, adventure fiction aside, nobody builds traps this obvious. Nobody sane, anyway. All the same, I want everyone to step back into the hallway, just in case.
Sir!
Bunyah!
Sir?
I want you waiting in the doorway. If something untoward does happen, I expect some modicum of effort to get me out of it. I'm not expecting miracles, of course, since someone gets a promotion in here if I die. But at least make it look good.
I'll certainly appear to do my damnedest, sir.
That's the spirit. All right, move.
A quick glance at young Bunyar, gravely returned with a nod, and Chappelle yanked on the lever.
Good God!
Agitated from beneath, a few dead limbs flailed about in a profane dance. The center of the floor opened up, revealing a hollow almost 10 feet on a side. Several corpses dropped into the gap. Chappelle, his face gone pale, realized that they had just lost the bodies of 5 or 6 of the city's elite. But the procedure, whatever it was not complete. A statue emerged from the newborn pit, rising to a full height of 18 feet, its horns almost brushing the rafters.
Timas.
The statue was carved in a crouch, as though it might leap to attack at any moment, bringing to bear the wicked axe slung over its left shoulder. Bedecked in furs that were carved with exquisite detail, sporting a beard so finely sculpted that it seemed possible to go and pluck a hair, it stared down at Chappelle with narrowed stone eyes. It looked for all the world to be a warrior of the ancient Northlands, save for the horns that jutted from its otherwise bald scalp.
Sir?
I'm fine, Constable. Bring the men back in here.
It clearly wasn't one of the 147 gods of the Pact. Or at least, not in any iconography recognized by the High Church. Worship of an unrecognized god wasn't technically illegal, but every city, every government organization, every guild, and every noble house of any repute claimed as their patrons a member of the Hallowed Pact. For all of these victims, each one claiming a different house and thus, most probably, a different patron, to have participated in rites devoted to an unrecognized deity, was another blemish to fuel an already scandalous situation.
Bunyar, help me search the statue. The rest of you keep counting bodies.
In the rafters above, some 8 feet from the leftmost horn, the filthy young woman glanced over her shoulder, pushing her matted and reeking hair from her face.
This doesn't actually change your situation, does it? Them seeing your idol, I mean?
A resounding sense of denial ran through Adrienne's body.
All right, this is bad. Still, I think we can talk our way—
Sergeant, I found something!
Oh, this keeps getting better.
The young constable pointed toward a carefully concealed catch at the rear of the idol.
It's a simple switch, set flush with the stone, just beneath the lip of the platform.
You seem to have a knack for finding these things, Bunya.
A drawer slid from the stone. It was so expertly crafted as to have been all but invisible. Within lay several small candles, a long quill, a jar of ink, and a wood-bound and velvet-wrapped ledger. Without so much as a pause for breath, Chappelle snapped up the book. Even the most casual examination suggested the book could be nothing less than a roster of membership for this strange little cult, each page devoted to one individual. There were no names. Gods forbid they should make this easy, but it did include dates, titles of rank, or seniority that were pretty much meaningless to the old guardsmen, and a monetary value listed in gold marks, perhaps indicating donations. Chappelle was quite sure he'd just found the motive for the horrific crimes. The sheer quantity of gold in the sect's coffers must be staggering. Why, the first 8 or 9 entries alone totaled up to more than 10,000 marks. From the rafters above, Adrienne Satie watched Chappelle flip through the ledger.
Well, that's just dandy. What kind of secret cult keeps written records? Can you tell me that?
Judging by the sudden sense of disapproval, the emotional equivalent of a saddened headshake, Adrienne was fairly certain he couldn't.
Don't you have any say over the doings of your own worshippers? Because I gotta tell you, the way they were running this thing...
Chappelle's men managed a tentative count of the dead, while he'd searched the statue and perused the ledger.
Not easy to be exact, sir, but we think 26.
The ledger contains 28 entries. At least 2 members unaccounted for. Inside job, Bunyar. I suppose it would almost have had to be.
Sir? What is it?
Didn't I hear Darian LaMarche listed among the dead?
Yes, I believe so.
How many of you men are up on the latest gossip?
Several guardsmen exchanged glances and guiltily raised their hands.
Was LaMarche still involved with Adrienne Satie?
Last I heard, yes, sir.
Find her, now!
They failed. No matter how they tried, they found no trace of Adrienne Satie among the dead. Chappelle nodded with each report, his expression growing ever more certain.
Damned aristocrats. I could have told him it would end badly with her. Although I didn't expect it would go this badly. We'll have these bodies picked up, gathered, and reassembled as best as possible. I'm fairly certain I know what's happened, but we have to identify them, all of them, to be sure.
The men fell eagerly in line to depart.
I also need a volunteer. Someone to stay behind and ensure the room's not disturbed until the cleanup workers arrive.
I'll stay, sir.
Roubaix.
Henri Roubaix, a blonde-haired constable some few years older than Julian himself, was called Resting Roubaix by the others in the unit. When Roubaix volunteers was, so far as they were concerned, roughly analogous to when pigs fly or when hell freezes over.
Well, perhaps this scene of depravity has kindled some residual spark of responsibility in you, Roubaix. Be ashamed to squelch it before it can spread. Very well, you're on watch. I don't imagine you'll be waiting too terribly long. Shouldn't be more than half an hour. Report to the main office when you've been relieved.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Julian Bunyar fell in line with his compatriots, but his expression remained thoughtful, his thoughts clearly on the man who stayed behind. Adrienne's throat closed and her eyes widened, first in surprise at hearing her name, then in mounting horror as the implications sank home. A hole opened in the pit of her stomach, just wide and deep enough for her soul to drop slowly and painfully through it.
Oh, gods. Oh, gods, they think I did this? How could they possibly think?
Adrienne felt once again a touch of sympathy in the back of her mind.
This is your fault! If you hadn't stopped me from going down to them, I could have explained it. I could have told them what really happened. Now, it's too late.
You'd better come down from there right now, Mademoiselle Satie, before I am forced to shoot you down.
Oh, stupid, stupid!
Adrienne peered downward, past the dusty beams on which she lay, past the horned form of the god. Henri Roubaix looked up at her, an odd expression plastered across his scruffy face. His rapier hung sheathed at his left hip, but in his right fist he clenched a gleaming flintlock pistol, a guard-issued special with a frame molded of brass rather than wood, reinforced to function as a brutally efficient headbreaker. In her youth, before the aristocracy, Adrienne had more than once been on the butt end of those so-called bash-bangs, but rarely had she stared so squarely down the barrel of one.
I'm not going to ask a second time.
Adrienne slid off the beam. Limber as a double-jointed cat, she swung from the nearest horn and clambered down the statue. She did not pause to acknowledge her incorporeal partner's sudden squawk of indignation at having his likeness used as a stepladder. Frowning thoughtfully, the guardsman took a moment to examine his catch, difficult as she was to see beneath the filth and caked blood. She looked to be maybe 15, give or take a year or two, still somewhere in that nether realm between childhood and womanhood. Her hair, to judge by the few unsoiled strands he could see, was an earthy brown, and her eyes shone with a blue-green hue so liquid that he almost expected to see waves. A small, ever so slightly upturned nose sat in the center of a slender face. Impossible to tell precisely what her outfit had looked like. What remained of it gave the rather hideous impression that she'd fashioned her wardrobe from the scraps left over on a slaughterhouse floor.
Do you normally find blood so fascinating, or am I special?
Rather clever of you to hide out. A pity you didn't notice me, or it might have worked.
Constable Roubaix aimed his flintlock unerringly at her bloody cleavage. Adrienne shot an aggravated glower toward the statue.
I was distracted.
But look at me, Constable. You can't honestly believe me capable of this, can you? I only survived by hiding in the rafters. I can only thank the gods that the killers weren't as observant as you were, or else...
Shut up before I shoot you. Even if I believed a word of it, it makes no difference. I'm not the man making the decisions here.
I think I'd like to speak to an advocate just as soon as possible.
I'm sure you would. If you hadn't tried to kill me during your escape, you might have lived long enough to do just that.
You're not a guardsman.
I am, actually. But I'm also a great deal more.
All right.
12 feet between us, give or take. I could cover that swiftly enough, but not so fast that he couldn't pull the trigger. Even if I reach him, I'm not armed.
So, what is it then? Dead women tell no tales? You blame all this on me and the real killers go free?
Something like that.
Rubé's arm straightened, the bashbang shifting until it came directly in line with her heart. The barrel gaped open before her, an endless tunnel to hell. Adrienne could not look away from it.
I'm sorry, Olgan. I tried.
She felt a brief surge of emotion from the near-dead god, followed by the faintest tingling in the air. She had just enough time to wonder if she'd imagined it. Shrapnel ripped through the soft flesh of Rubé's hand and arm. The remainder of the now useless weapon dropped to the floor. Rubé crumpled to the floor, clutching the bleeding wreckage of his hand to his chest.
Oh! Well, that was convenient.
Adrienne felt a brief swell of satisfaction from her divine partner, but it was no match for her own sense of satisfaction as she darted forward and kicked Rubé in the head until he was well and truly unconscious.
Olgan, we gotta get out of here. They think I did this, and I sort of doubt that Lefty here is gonna tell them otherwise. We've gotta hide until I can figure out what to do or how to get back to Alexandra.
Another questioning probe.
I don't know. It doesn't matter, really. I grew up out there, remember? The guardsman hasn't been born that can find Adrienne Satie when she doesn't want to be found.
8 years before 26 of Davion's aristocrats were massacred, brick walls and wooden fences were the borders of 9-year-old Adrienne's world, roads of dirt or broken cobblestone its fields, rickety staircases its trees. The city wasn't just a big place at her age, her size. It was all there was, all there ever could be. Adrienne had spent much of that day with friends who, like her, were ducking out on various chores. Rag-clad and dirt-faced, they moved in a feral pack, yipping, screeching, and giggling. Their chins dripped with the juices of fruits they hadn't paid for. Their wrists, arms, and shoulders ached with the iron grasp of merchants who snagged them before they could run. But those swift or fortunate enough to catch them were far less numerous than the shopkeepers who never knew they'd been robbed. The children pushed, slipped, shoved, and squeezed through barricades of flesh and cloth, through bustling markets and crowded streets. The heat of bodies pressed together was enough to make them sweat, despite winter's chill in the air and a dusting of snow on the rooftops. They shouldn't really have been so far from home, unsupervised, but their parents had long since given up forbidding them to go. Futility was a common enough guest in the poorer quarters of Davion. No sense in inviting him for an extra stay. No sense at all. Young as she was, Adrienne had some vague sense of responsibility. There were some chores that needed doing, and she wouldn't want her parents to worry. The fact that it was growing late, and that her stomach, unsatisfied by purloined produce, was rumbling for dinner, had, of course, nothing at all to do with it. A few shouted farewells, a few insults and protruding tongues, and Adrienne left her friends. Today, given her own limited frame of reference, had been a good day. She watched with a delight that she hadn't yet outgrown as clouds of dirt puffed up around her worn and ragged shoes. The forest of legs thinned as she moved farther from the market, and she began to shiver as the season coughed and wheezed across her skin. She kept her head low, wrapped her arms around herself in a quest for the warmth her tunic failed to offer, and mumbled aspersions upon her friends. It must have been their fault she'd stayed out so late. It wasn't the change in the constant roar of the city's voice. People were always shouting about something or other. It wasn't the faint stinging in her eyes, or the cough that kept traveling up and down her throat like a yo-yo. No, it was the sudden gust of warmth, a comforting yet confounding relief from winter winds that finally drew her attention. At first, she saw nothing but the muted colors and shoddy fabrics that covered the legs and backs of the people before her in the road. More of them, in fact, than was entirely normal. Higher, her gaze drifted, to the flickering glow and the plumes of smoke twisting their way skyward. Even at her age, she knew the dangers of fire, especially in a neighborhood as poor as this. Should she run the other way, find a place to hide? Offer, however small she might be, to help? Mother and father would know. With a hitch in her breath, as much fear as it was smoke now, she wormed her way through the growing crowd. and then she was near enough to see precisely which building was on fire. The frantic adult simply stepped over her as she fell to her knees in the middle of the road, and her scream was just another voice, lost amid the many voices of the city. After losing her family, and really her whole life, young Adrienne was sent to a convent orphanage where children ate from cheap wooden bowls with cheap wooden spoons, scooping up mouthfuls of cheap porridge. Probably not wooden, but who could really say for certain?
And as ever and always, to your endless grace, Vercool, to you our most humble thanks for the prosperity you have brought us, the safety you have brought us, for Davillon, which is both your gift to us and our greatest testament to you. In your name, above all, we pray. Amen.
Sister Cataline surveyed the quartet of long tables, crammed to bursting with unwashed children clad in undyed frocks. There had been a time, oh so long ago, when she felt horrible that the convent couldn't provide a more comfortable life for these unfortunate waifs, when she felt guilty that her own blue and silver habit was so much better kept than the clothes they offered these lost souls. Once, but not now. She did all she could, but no longer lamented her inability to do more. She'd seen too many of them in her years, and simply couldn't afford to care any more than she had to.
You're not hungry, child?
Who's Vercool?
You don't know Vercool, child?
Nuh-uh.
Why, he's our patron god. Vercool, above all others, watches over Davillon.
What others?
The gods of the Hallowed Pact, of course.
What's the Hallowed Pact?
Good gods, is nobody teaching these children anything? Little heathens running the streets of Davillon.
The nun really wanted nothing more than to get the children finished up and put to bed, but even her cynicism recognized a spiritual obligation when it appeared before her.
The Hallowed Pact refers to all the gods of the High Church, child. Uncounted gods ruled before our forefathers carved Galice from the lands of the barbarian tribes. The 147 greatest of them joined together over civilization, promising to watch over humanity.
And
Vercool.
Vercool's the biggest?
I certainly think so. Here in Davignon, he's the greatest. In other cities, he probably stands as the patron of only a single guild or a bloodline. Just as, for instance, as Bannon is the patron of two or three of Davignon's noble houses. But elsewhere, he might be the patron of a great guild or even an entire city. Do you understand, child?
Yes?
Go back to your meal, child.
Can I ask one more question?
One more. Then you need to eat your supper.
If Davillon has so many gods, how come not one of them got off his butt to save my mommy and daddy?
Young lady, that is not an appropriate way to speak of the gods.
When they explain themselves to me, I'll apologize.
Well, it is positively past time to nip this in the bud.
Ow!
We're going to have to teach you some manners and respect, child.
Stop calling me child. My name is Adrienne.
Adrienne did not, as it happened, learn either manners or respect from Sister Cataline or any of the other nuns either. Despite the chains, the locks, the heavy doors, and the fact that she frankly had nowhere better to go, she was gone from the convent after only a few days, before the welts of her lashing had even fully faded. Sister Cataline wasn't truly sorry to see her go.
That one, I am certain, would have been nothing but trouble.
The present. Most attending the ball at the enormous Dumerge estate still remembered the tragic massacre of 2 years ago, which shook many of Davillon's most powerful houses. But tonight saw a different sort of aristocratic chaos. A cluster of musicians played furiously, lobbing their music into the crowd like arrows, reproducing the most popular tunes making the rounds of courts and noble soirees throughout Galice. They wore lavish fabrics in a hypnotic mishmash of garish colors. Tunics and vests hung haphazardly. Wigs sat askance atop sweaty heads. Abused fingers ached in protest. For 5 hours they'd played, with never more than a few minutes between songs, and the torment didn't promise an end anytime soon. The table was long and laden with a quantity of food not merely sufficient to choke a large elephant, but also to bury its remains. Every variety of animal could be found, smothered in sauce, breading, dressing, or gods alone knew what. Beef, venison, fowl of every variety, at least a dozen types of fish, eggs of both fish and fowl, escargot, every vegetable known to man. And no matter how much the guests ate, a criminal amount of food would go to waste. The smell alone was heavy enough to satiate a smaller appetite without a single bite. Paintings and tapestries hung high on the walls, well beyond the reach of drunken fingers or spilled foods. Most were pastoral or mythic scenes, but several depicted the golden pyramid of Giron, patron deity of the Doré line, and a scant few boasted the sun and crown of Vercoul, Davion's high patron. Various herbs and scents were sprinkled upon the numerous blazing hearths, filling the room with a bizarre combination of odors that spun around the guests before rising to cluster at the ceilings, arches, and buttresses. Servants, immaculately groomed, stood at attention or bustled about the rooms, preparing this, refilling that, playing the part of so many trained hounds. And in the center of the maelstrom, buffeted on all sides by eddies and swirls of humanity, stood an unlikely pair. Despite the press of partygoers and the constant blank smiles, polite waves, and spouted small talk, they exuded an aura of calm, a globe of peace that extended a scant few feet from them.
I must say, my dear Baron, you've really outdone yourself. I can't recall when I've last attended festivities so elegant.
Other than those I've planned myself.
The gentleman bowed in gratitude, his face partially hidden behind a loosely clutched kerchief held dangling from long, spidery fingers.
The Duchess is too kind.
She is, isn't she?
Beatrice Lucien, the Duchess d'Avion, voice of Vercoul, landholder and ruler over all territories claimed by the duchy, province, and city of d'Avion, was just shy of 6 feet, and broad of shoulders, hips, and features. Her hair, black going gray, was piled high above her head in a mountain of curls that failed utterly to soften a face grown taut with age. She wore rich purples and reds and blues, as well as a golden sun and crown brooch, and her face was powdered to within a shade of newly fallen snow. Her host, by contrast, was a short, bony shadow of a weasel of a man. Charles Dumerge, the Baron Doré, looked perennially ill. His skin was near gray, even without the benefits of powder, and his limp, straw-colored hair was thinning faster than a slug in a salt shaker. Not even his finest outfit of blues and browns made him look any less the walking corpse.
I'm grateful that I've guests here with the appropriate, shall we say, refinement, to appreciate my efforts.
Dumerge furtively glanced around, as though ensuring he wouldn't be overheard.
The truth is, I don't believe that everyone here is quite suited to this sort of thing. If I may be brutally honest with you, Your Grace, I'd not have chosen to invite, say...
Dumerge cast about quickly for a safe target.
The Marquis de Brielle. The fellow simply doesn't have what it takes to survive in our particular arena, you see. But, well, poor Francis has had such a difficult time of it of late. It would have been boorish not to offer him the opportunity to escape his problems. Still, I doubt that he's properly able to...
Francis Carnot has done quite well, considering the title of Marquis was expected to fall to his late brother Gaston. I consider the gentleman a friend, and I look forward to the day when he has managed to get his house back on its feet.
Beatrice peered down on her unpleasant little host, her expression lofty. Floundering wildly for a distraction, the Baron's gaze fell upon another guest nearby, a pretty young woman currently standing alone amidst the swirl of people. Dumerge reached his stick-thin arms and wormy finger to grasp at the young lady's elbow.
Your Grace, have you met Mademoiselle Valois? No? Well, then, I present to you Madeleine Valois. Mademoiselle Valois, this is Beatrice Lucien, the Duchess d'Avion.
The young lady, with her slender face, sharp features, aquatic eyes, and a head piled high with lavish blonde curls, blinked twice, her only sign of surprise, and curtsied elegantly.
Your Grace, I'm honored.
The Duchess acknowledged the young woman's genuflection with a shallow nod. With an artfully concealed flicker of amusement at Dumerge's clumsy diversion, Lucien gave the newcomer a brief once-over.
Scarcely more than a child. Those curls are clearly a wig. But half the women here are sporting wigs, so that hardly matters. That gown, such a heavy thing, all those forest green velvets. All told, little about her separates her in any way, shape, or form from a dozen other ladies of quality. And yet...
It seems to me that I have seen you somewhere before, my dear.
Almost certainly, Your Grace. I've been privileged to attend several balls and dinners before tonight, but this is the first time that anyone has done me the honor of formally acquainting us.
Ah. Well, it's certainly been a pleasure to meet you, dear. Do enjoy the rest of the party, yes? Good Baron, I believe that you and I were in the midst of a discussion.
Whew. Well, that was interesting, Olgan. I thought we'd been found out.
Heartfelt agreement, tinged with a patina of relief, flowed from her unseen companion, followed by a sense of inquiry.
No, I'm not worried about the Baron. That clown wouldn't comprehend a real threat if someone hit a manticore in his chamber pot. I was afraid the Duchess might have recognized me, though.
Another surge of emotion, almost, but not quite, nostalgia.
It was a long time ago, yes. But enough worrying.
Sliding through the forest of humanity, Madeleine, who 2 years before had been Adrienne, continued to survey the house, absorbing every detail. Irritably, she shook her head, careful not to dislodge her wig and reveal the thick brown hair beneath.
All right. He's not allowed any of his guests upstairs, so I'll wager that's where he keeps most of his valuables. I wish I had a chance to look at the layout up there. It would make this all so much easier. Oh well. We're only human, yes?
Somehow, without the use of a single coherent word, Olgan growled something impolite.
Right. As if I'll wake up one morning and forget I have a god riding around in my head. Well, it's time for Madeleine Valois to make her farewells.
Gradually, she allowed the flow of the party to edge her ever nearer the door, preparing the way for a different and uninvited guest. Several pairs of eyes watched as Madeleine Valois made her graceful exit from the Baron Doré's soirée. Most were potential admirers, sorry to see so lovely a creature depart from their midst. One was not. All the houses of Davillon boasted their own guards. Even if most never saw the slightest action, it was simply not done to go without. Some were veritable armies unto themselves, while others consisted of anyone who could stand up straight and look competent while making parade ground turns in formal wear or old-fashioned armor. Dumerge's guards were largely of the latter category, which meant that the Baron's hiring requirements were rather more lax than those of the city guard. And that meant that, though his ruined hand had cost him his commission in said guard, Henri Roubaix had never lacked for a position. This wasn't
the first. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.